In this video, we're going to continue our investigation of what it means to take the exponential of a matrix. And we're going to see that by diagonalizing the matrix, we'll understand the exponential of a matrix very well. Okay, so let's recap what we learned last time. We learned that if you have a real number, you can define the exponential e to the at to be a function where the f prime of t is a times f of t, and f of 0 is 1. And if a is a real number, then e to the at is a real number. If a is a complex number, maybe you want to call it z instead of a, then f of t is the complex valued function whose derivative is a times f of t, and whose value at 0 is 1. And you could also use a power series. Whether a is real or complex, you can define e to the at to be the sum of a to the n t to the n over n factorial. Now, what if A is a matrix? Well, the same kinds of definitions work. So if A is a square matrix, then we'll consider a function. I'm going to call it capital F of t, just because we're using capital letters for matrices. So it's a matrix-valued function whose derivative is A times F of t. Now, here A is a matrix and F of t is a matrix, but you can multiply two matrices together to get a matrix. And we want f of 0. Now we don't want it to be the number 1 anymore. We want it to be the identity. And we could have done it with a power series. And you can check that these are equivalent, because just like before, if you take the derivative of this power series term by term, you get a times itself. And if you plug in t equals 0, you get the identity. So this power series satisfies the differential equation. So use one, you like one definition, you like the other definition, doesn't matter which one. And what do I mean by a to the n? I don't mean taking the nth power of each matrix entry. I mean taking the matrix times the matrix times the matrix times the matrix n times, and a to the 0 means the identity. Okay. Now, for computing these exponentials, diagonalizing the matrix helps a lot. Because if A is PDP inverse, well, then A squared is PDP inverse times PDP inverse. But the P's in the middle cancel, and you get P times D squared times P inverse. And likewise, if you take A to the N, you're going to get P times D to the N times P inverse. So whenever you take the nth power of a matrix, you see, this is diagonal. And so you've got a matrix times diagonal times the inverse of a matrix. So that means that the eigenvalues of A to the N are the columns of P. And those are just the eigenvectors of A to the N are the columns of P. And those are just the eigenvectors of A. And the eigenvalues of A to the N are the entries of D to the N. And those are just the nth powers of the eigenvalues of A. So the eigenvectors stay the same. The eigenvalues, you take powers. And if you want to think, put it another way, D is this diagonal matrix. D to the N is take the nth powers of all the eigenvalues. And if you have the A is P, D, P inverse. A to the N is P, D to the N, P inverse. Eigenvectors are the same. Eigenvalues are not the same. Okay. So now we can figure out what e to the at is using our power series. We want this sum, but we know that a to the n is just p times d to the n times p inverse. So we can pull the p and the p inverse out of this whole expression and get the sum of d to the n, t to the n over n factorial, and a p inverse on the right. And that means, well, d to the n is just lambda to the n, and so you add up all the terms, and you get a diagonal matrix whose entries are these sums. But these sums aren't any old function. We saw that whether lambda is real or complex, that these sums give you e to the lambda t. So what you get is p times a diagonal matrix whose entries are the exponentials of the original eigenvalues. So e to the at has exactly the same eigenvectors as A, because they're the columns of P, and its eigenvalues are e to the lambda 1t, e to the lambda 2t, e to the lambda 3t, e to the lambda mt. And remember, the lambda may be complex, in which case e to the lambda t, you have to understand that as e to the real part t, that's how big it is, and then the imaginary part tells you how fast its phase goes around and around and around. Okay, now if you don't like power series, you could also get it from the differential equation. You see, I claimed that this was e to the at, was p times these eigenvalues times p inverse. Let's check to see if it satisfies the differential equation. We take its derivative, and you just take a derivative term by term. P doesn't depend on t, so it comes along for the ride, and so does p inverse. What you have in the middle is lambda 1 e to the lambda 1t, bang, 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 lambda m e to the lambda mt. That's just the derivative of e to the lambda t is lambda e to the lambda t. And then if you have something whose diagonal entries are lambda e to the lambda t, you can write that as a product of two terms, one whose diagonal entries are lambda and one whose diagonal entries are e to the lambda t. And I could put in a p inverse p here, and that doesn't change anything. And then we notice that this is A, and this is our function f of t. So we've just shown that the derivative of f is A times f. And it's not hard to see that if you take f of 0, you're taking e to the 0 lambda for each one, so you get the identity. So p times the identity times p inverse is the identity. So if you prefer the differential equation approach, that works too. Okay. And that's it for the exponential. Now if you have other functions of A, you can define the sine of a matrix, or the cosine of the matrix, or the log of a matrix, or any analytic function. If you've got any function that can be expressed as an infinite power series, then you can define that function of a matrix to be just the same power series. It's just instead of taking powers of x, you're taking powers of the matrix. And the same rules about diagonalization work. Now here's some examples. The sine of a matrix, the natural log of the identity plus the matrix. I'm just taking the power series for sine of x, or the power series of 1 plus x, and I'm replacing x with a. And as long as the eigenvalues sit within the radius of convergence of this power series, the matrix series will converge. And diagonalization is handy. If a is pdp inverse, a to the n is pd to the np inverse, and g of a, we add these all up, and we discover that we just change the eigenvalues from lambda to g of lambda, and the eigenvectors stay the same. Okay. Now, what happens if the matrix is not diagonalizable? If a matrix is not diagonalizable, then the definition of g of a is still good. We still say that g of a is given by the power series. This definition makes sense whether a is diagonalizable or not. But if a is not diagonalizable, evaluating g of a is sometimes trickier. Okay, enough said.